Well, good morning, Life Church family. How's everybody doing today? I sound really loud. Do I sound really loud to you? And I'm going to get louder. So they better take me. Yeah, there you go. Now I'm not loud enough. What's the deal? There we go. Hey, it is so very, very good to be at the Greater Lafayette campus of the Life Church family. I'll tell you what. I look so very forward, my wife and I both do, to being here with you. John and Britt always look forward to going back to the Danville campus and being there with them. But one thing that is so awesome, how many know we are one church, two locations, isn't that right? So whether we're here or whether we're there, we are with family. And I'll tell you, one of the things that's been nice, we're living in some kind of crazy times right now, I realize that. And, you know, had to meet online for a while. Wasn't that awesome? Interesting, but anyway. And now we're gathering back again, and it has been good at the Danville campus to see familiar faces that are new. In other words, they are there for the first time, and each Sunday we have those people who are there. But what's been really interesting is since service one, since we started coming back, we have had new people with us in every service. And so we're very thankful for that. It's just crazy how things work sometimes. And I'm not exactly sure what's been happening over here with regard to that. But I will tell you this, it's been a while since I've been over here. And I definitely have seen some new faces, people that I have never had the privilege, the opportunity of meeting or seeing here before. And so it looks like good things are happening here. You know, back the first of the year, I'm one of these guys, I just always pray and just seek God's face as far as, you know, what the new year has for us. And by the way, God never told me there was a pandemic coming. I kind of wish he had it. Maybe, I don't know, maybe then again I wouldn't, I don't know. But anyway, it's not what he told me. What he put in my heart was just an expectation for great things and believing that 2020 was going to be an absolutely great year. And I will tell you this, while the pandemic and all the racial tensions and everything that is there has certainly been a challenge for all of us this year. My expectations are still high. I'm still seeing God doing some great things, and I am believing God for even greater things in the weeks and the months and the days ahead for us. And I also believe that 2021 is going to be an even more awesomer year. Amen. And I know awesomer is not a right word. But just seeing if you're awake, some of you might, anyway, moving right along. You know, I was thinking, and I don't have a lot of time to share, so I'm going to have to give you the essence of what I want to talk about anyway this morning. But I was thinking, and I've not thought about this. This is what's crazy. And here we are, you know, with the pandemic and everything going on. And what's interesting here is Kathy and Brett are here. They know this is true. My wife and I started Life Church Danville 40 years ago this December. 40 years ago. I know, I was 8 when I started the church. Yeah. But, 40 years ago we started church. What's interesting about that is this. In December of 1980, there was gas shortage, gas rationing. For any of you who are old enough to remember this, you had to get in line. You could only get so much, and it was expensive. Interest rates, it had the opposite effect on the economy at the time. The economy is terrible, don't get me wrong. But the interest rates were 18%, not 2.5%, 3%. They were 18%. In fact, the first money I ever borrowed at the church to do anything cost me 18%. And so I'll never forget that and don't ever want to do that again. Been there, done that, got a T-shirt, and don't ever want that T-shirt again. So we started in the middle of a recession, gas shortages, all that. And now, 40 years later, we're going to celebrate 40 years of history at Life Church, and we're doing it, you know, in the middle of a pandemic. So here's why I bring that up. I will tell you, after 40 years, I'm like David. I was young, and now I'm a little older. But I will tell you this, through those 40 years, whether it was the recession on the front end or the pandemic right now, God has been faithful to see us through those times. He has always provided for us. We have always come out on the other side victorious. And in Jesus' name, I make the declaration to Life Church and also to you, if you receive it, we're coming out of this. We're coming out on the other side better Yeah. I mean, you put this lion and bear down behind us, and we get victory over it. What Goliath, what giant are we going to be ready to defeat that comes at us in the days ahead? Amen? So anyway, so very good to be here with you, and great to have those of you who are with us online today watching. Always so thankful for you to be a part of what's going on, because we do realize that there are more maybe who are a part of Life Church who aren't with us in service, but you are with us in spirit. And so whether you're here or whether you're sitting at home, wherever you're at, we are so very grateful to have you worshiping online with us today. For the last several weeks, I've been talking about the subject of passion. And I consider myself to be a pretty passionate person. I think my wife would tell you I'm a pretty passionate guy in many ways. Passionate about my love for her. Passionate about my family, most definitely. Passionate maybe about a few other things, but I'm passionate about God's Word. I'm a Word guy, man. I mean, I love God's Word. But you know, more than anything else, I'm passionate about God, my relationship with Him. And I'm very passionate about the church. Not just Life Church, I'm just passionate about the church in general. And so I want to talk to all of you today who are passionate, and even those who may not consider yourselves to be passionate, because you are. I've had people in the church who just said, you know, that's not my personality. I'm not a real demonstrative. I'm not a real passionate person. And okay, so, you know, it's like it's, you know, part of your character, part of your personality. You just, you know, a sanguine or whatever. And then I go to their kids' ball games with them, and I see their kid hit a home run, or I see the ump call a bad call, and I watch the parent, and I think, nah, you're pretty passionate. You're pretty passionate. You're just not as passionate in church as you are in other places. We're all passionate about something, isn't that right? You know, I think we'd all agree that the pandemic has had a huge impact on all of us and on all of our lives in so very many ways. I think it's affected every aspect of our life. Obviously, physically, there are people who have come down with the virus. We've had people in our church who've had the virus, some that recovered. And I think we had one gentleman, he actually was an in-law that passed. And we got a guy right now who is in the hospital and struggling. We're believing God that he's going to come out victorious. But so it's hit some, many, physically. It has definitely financially taken a toll on very, very many people. I think maybe one of the greatest impacts it has had on people is certainly emotionally, just the whole psychological impact it has on us of us being isolated and out of our routines. We're not designed to be isolated. We're not created to separate like that. We are designed for community. We need to be. That's why we need to be gathering in God's house. We don't just say that because, you know, it's a nice thing for you to do if you're a Christian. You really need it. You need it spiritually in order to stay on course. You'll see that as I talk today, you know. So I think it's also taken a huge impact on us spiritually. And as a pastor, which I am, it's what I've been for so many years, I get very concerned about the congregation whenever I see something having a negative impact on them. We were a couple of months, maybe, I don't even know if it was that, but a couple of months into the pandemic, into the having to do church online, and it was kind of the new deal, the cool deal. And, hey, this is going to be great. We're actually reaching more people. And, yep, we did. And I think we continue to do that. It's one dynamic of things that we will continue with services online moving forward. But about 6 weeks, 8 weeks into it, John and Britt would both tell you that I told them this is not good. And I know that everybody thinks it's really great. It's not good. It's going to have a negative impact on the church, not just our church. It's going to have a negative impact on the church. Because what's cool right now will get real, it will become common every day. It will be very easy to be distracted when you're endeavoring to watch online and participate in things. You'll catch yourself doing other things. Kids will be bothered. You know, next thing you know, you're just not in the habit of, you know, really gathering, worshiping God and being very focused on that like you once were. And it will have a negative impact on the body of Christ. And I didn't know it, but I was speaking a little bit prophetically, maybe a whole lot prophetically there, as far as, you know, the impact it was going to have, because just a month and a half, 2 months later, however long it took to gather the stats, there is a place called the Barna Group, and they gather information about the church to kind of see what the pulse of the church is, how the church is doing, that type of thing. It's one of the most, trusted places there are when it comes to churches and pastors looking to finding trends, things like that. I'm not a trendy guy, but I do like finding out, you know, what's going on. And so here's what they said. They said that out of 100% of all the people who normally would be attending church, only 34% of people have actually returned to church. Only 34% of everybody who was originally gathering is now getting back in church and gathering again. Again, we're seeing people come back each week. Praise God for that, but that's the national average right now. 32% of the people are still watching online, but not necessarily their church. In other words, they're watching, other churches online rather than their own church, which, you know, you think, well, that doesn't, well, I'm getting to check out this and check out, listen to this verse. And it's a verse I've taught from so very, very many times, but I saw some things in it that I've never seen before, and they're really very simple, as Revelation very often is. Romans chapter 12, verse 11, Paul's talking to the church, talking to us today. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor. We get our word fever from there. Obviously, it is implying heat. Keep your spiritual heat, serving the Lord. Lacking in zeal, zeal is obviously passion. So he's saying never lose your passion. Always keep your spiritual heat, serving the Lord. And, what I saw there was a word that, I really believe God caused me to latch onto out of that, is the word never. Wasn't the word zeal, wasn't the word fervor, as it always been, has been when I'm teaching on this, it was the word never. And I'd never noticed the word never, or at least it had never caught my attention like this. And I realized when Paul says never be lacking in zeal, he meant, I looked it up in the dictionary, and you know what never means? It means never. It means not at any time. Now, see, here's the problem. A lot of us don't think that way. We just think that, you know, life's going to take its toll. You go through a tough time like this. It's understandable how someone could lose their passion. And yet, Paul says, never be lacking in passion. Keep your spiritual fervor. And so there should never be a time, there should never be a season in our life when we are lacking in passion when it comes to our relationship with God and our love for His house. I love the way the Passion Translation reads. Since I'm teaching on passion, I've been reading the Passion Bible a lot because it says things very passionately. And it says it this way. I love it. Be enthusiastic to serve the Lord. Keep your passion towards Him boiling hot. Radiate with the glow of the Holy Spirit. Wow. Enthusiastic. Passion that is boiling, glowing with the Holy Spirit. Does that sound like you? That sound like you as a Christian, you and your walk with God? You know, I think about glowing with the Holy Spirit, you know. And for whatever reason, I naturally just think about Moses coming down off the mount, having spent time in the presence of God. Stay with me here. Track with me. I can't say everything that I would like to say. Comes down off that mount after spending time with God, and he is radiating with the glory of God, the presence of God in his life. He's glowing, if you would please, with the Holy Spirit, so much so that they have to put a veil on his face because the people can't even look at him because it's almost blinding, or is blinding. I'm not saying you ought to walk around with a blinding glow. That might not be too conducive to being able to witness to people or live out your everyday life. But I tell you what, there ought to be a difference in your countenance, a difference in your presence than there is in the guy that you show up to work with or the guy that whatever, down the street that has no relationship with God, doesn't know Him, doesn't spend time in His presence. There ought to be something different about us. I get around a lot of Christians. There's nothing different about them right now. Oh, this pandemic. Yeah, I know. They keep saying, yeah, I know. Probably going to get worse. This, that. I mean, just say, it's just, there's no faith, just fear and negativity. And are we all identifying? We're identifying with each other, but we're not helping each other. You got CNN and Fox News to give you all the negative news just 24 hours a day. All you got to do is listen. It's just constantly negative right now. Listen, there's enough stuff out there producing fear. We need something in our lives that is producing faith. And I will tell you this, you do not get in God's presence, you do not spend time in His Word, and ever come out with even an inkling of fear in your life. You get in God's presence and in His Word, you're going to come out with faith stirred on the inside of your heart. Amen. I show up in the right place. Somebody's saying, what's wrong with this guy? He's crazy. I'm passionate. Very passionate. I can't really see your faces, so I can't really tell whether you're receiving. I see my wife and my daughter-in-law. That's good enough for me. So, if my wife doesn't go, I'm going to keep plowing. I love it. And then he goes, and let him fill you with excitement as you serve the Lord. Well, we got to show up at church today. I'm back on the schedule today. Don't really want to be. Not crazy about it right now. Let him fill you with excitement as you serve the Lord. I don't know. I think I might be more excited about serving him right now because the need is greater. People are so down. They need encouragement. Oh, wow. They could use me right now. They could use you right now. Come on. Fill us with excitement. Anybody in here need a fill up? Yeah, come on. So, real quickly, three questions I want to answer in the short amount of time I have, and I'll answer them quickly, I promise you. I got about 15 minutes here. And for me to preach anything in 20 or 30 minutes is just, it's an absolute miracle. So, but we're doing okay. So, why is passion so important? Do we know? We just talk about being passionate. Why is it so important? Is it really a big deal that I be passionate? Is being passionate even spiritual? Well, I think it's very, very spiritual. And when you look at the Bible, there's so much there I didn't even really think about until I started working on this series where we're just challenged and encouraged to be passionate about so very much when it comes to our walk with God. So why is passion so important? And by the way, the enemy knows how important passion is. See, here's the deal. The enemy has been doing this a long time. He knows what really matters in our life and what doesn't. There are a lot of things he doesn't bother us with that we might kind of think is important. He doesn't bother us with it because he knows it's really not that important. But there are other things that he knows are really important, and so those are the areas that he hits you in. And passion, he knows how vitally important it is in your life, and so he's always trying to steal, to kill, and to rob you of your passion. Think about the times in your life, just through life's up and downs, just through sometimes the dry seasons that we may go through in our life. What is it that really suffers, that takes the hit during those times? So very often, if we're not careful, it's our passion. We're not as excited. We're not as zealous about God and the things of God as we once were. And so the enemy knows that. And so the first reason is really, I think, the most important reason. Is passion determines what you pursue and what you're devoted to. Passion, what you're passionate about, will always determine what you pursue. If you're passionate about medicine and you know, finding medical cures, whatever, man, that's what you're going to pursue, and that's what you're going to devote yourself to. You're going to go to college for that. You know, if you're passionate about animals, you're going to pursue, you know, helping animals that are in the shelters and stuff like that. And that's what you're going to be kind of devoted to. And, you know, if you're passionate about, you know, babies, you're probably going to be very much into, the abortion thing and just, you know, trying to reach mothers who are considering that and discourage them from having the abortion. And again, it's just what you pursue. It's what you're devoted to. And the Apostle Paul said it like this. He said, listen, I am a Jew of all Jews, and I mean, if anybody has studied and if anybody has been very passionate about the things they've done before Christ, he said, I was killing Christians because I thought it was the right thing to do, you know. And then he talks about his education and all the degrees, but he says, all those things are nothing to me. In fact, he says, I count them as lost. Another one says, I count them as dung. I mean, that's about as worthless as you can get. And then he says, here's what I'm passionate about. He says, that I may know him. And then, you know what else he says down in those verses? This one thing I do, not these 10 things I dabble at. This one thing I do. Man, I press toward the mark for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ. I want to lay hold of everything that I've been laid hold of for in Christ. Ooh, I like that. Sounds like a passionate man to me. Can you see that? So see, passion will determine what I pursue and what I'm devoted to. Now these, I've got to say them real quick, and you'll just have to write them down. Passion is the creative force behind anything great. If you think about great art, if you think about great architecture, I don't care what it is, when you know somebody that's great in sports, it just really doesn't matter. Passion is the creative force behind anything great. You know what? We want to have a great church at Life Church. We want to have a great church at Life Church. We want to have a great teaching team. We want to have a great worship team. We want to have a great kids' life. We want to have a great students' ministry. We just want everything about our church to be great. Come on. Anybody else want your church to be great? Can I tell you what? If we're going to have a great church, it's got to be, listen, led by people who are very passionate about the cause of Christ, surrounded by a team that shares that passion, and supported by people who are so passionate about it also that they're using their gift and their resources to help accomplish what God has put in our hearts. Amen? You got to have passion if you're going to do anything great. Some kind of half-hearted, you know, lackluster effort is not going to produce anything great. Passion produces energy in you, produces energy in those around you. If I'm kind of dead in the water, I'm not going to be very inspirational, encouraging to anybody else. If I'm passionate, I'm going to bring some energy, not just to my life, I'm going to bring some energy to theirs. And I'm going to bring energy to what it is that I'm doing. Can you all see that? Yeah, absolutely. Passion releases potential. People, once they find out this is what they're passionate about, man, it'll just start releasing all this crazy potential, not just in them, but in those around them. And passion is also the thing that gets us through the tough times. In fact, passion is actually a word that means, it implies willingness to suffer. It comes from Jesus dying on the cross. That's where the word actually originated. It came about as a result to explain what Jesus went through on the cross of Calvary for all of us, which obviously was a willingness to suffer. So passion, without spending any more time on this part of it, is just so very, very important. Steve Jobs says this: you have to have a lot of passion for what you're doing because it's so hard. If you don't, any reasonable person would give up. I've been around a lot of reasonable people in my life. I'm not a reasonable person. Passionate people, they just don't give up. Again, my family will tell you, I just don't give up. I get knocked down, but I get up again. No, you're never going to keep me down. I never can remember who sings that song, but I like that part. And John Bon Jovi, any John Bon Jovi lovers in here, you enjoy his music? I do. I'm just an old rocker. I still enjoy good music, living on a prayer. No. Anyway, John Bon Jovi says nothing. He's a passionate guy if you listen to him. Nothing is as important as passion. No, no matter what you want to do with your life, be passionate. Everybody say, be passionate. All right. So what am I supposed to be passionate about? Well, we're all a little different, and there's a reason why some of us are passionate about some of the things I mentioned earlier, because that's how God wants to use us in life. And yet, there are some common things that we're all supposed to be very passionate about as believers, and really, they're two. And Jesus not only told us, he also showed us what we're supposed to be passionate about. How many of you want to be like Jesus? Jesus was a very passionate person. Come on. And he told us what we are supposed to be passionate about. First of all, there's a man came to him one day, Pharisee, and he says, hey, what's the greatest, most important commandment of all? And I love the way the Passion Translation reads, you're to love the Lord your God with every passion of your heart, with every passion of your heart, with all the energy of your being, with every thought that is within you, and with your strength. This is the great and supreme commandment. Wow. Can I tell you why that's the great and supreme commandment? Two reasons. First of all, because God loves you that way, and no one wants to be in a one-way relationship where they love you passionately and you love them back half-heartedly. I don't want that in my relationship with my wife. Amen? How do I know God loves you passionately? Exodus chapter 34, verse 14. You must worship no other gods but only the Lord. And one translation says he's jealous. This is the way this word reads. For he is a God who is passionate. Oh, he's passionate about his relationship with you. How do I know he's passionate? Look at the cross. The cross demonstrates just how passionate Jesus was about his relationship with you. God was about his relationship with you. God so loved you, so loved you that he gave his one only son so that whoever believes on him would not perish but have everlasting. That's passion, man. That's passion. Amen? So it says, well, that's one reason. What's the other reason? Because if you love God with all your heart, with everything that is within you, the other 9 commandments, you'll do anyway. Because, see, you'll want to live in such a way as to please him. And so you'll never want to transgress him, never want to displease him. And so you won't covet your neighbor's stuff or, you know, commit adultery or whatever. Not because because you want to be faithful to your spouse. Yes, absolutely. But more than anything, I want to be faithful to my God. He's passionate about his relationship with me. I want to be passionate about my relationship with him. Amen. So that's the first thing we're supposed to be passionate about. Second thing we're supposed to be passionate about is the church. Oh, now you prove that with the relationship. You can't prove that with the church. Really? I thought we were supposed to be like Jesus. Do you remember in John chapter 2 when he is about to go into the temple and he gets there and he sees the money changers selling sheep, goats, and everything else, and exchanging money, foreign currencies, what it says. And man, he gets so upset about that what's he do? He goes and he makes a whip. How many know to make a whip? That's premeditation. I mean, you got to think about that, and it's going to take a moment to do it. He stays fired up long enough to get that whip made, and, you know, I don't know if Peter was over there saying, Jesus, I don't know if you really should do this or not. I don't know about this. This ain't going to be cool, man. What are people going to think? Man, he is so stirred on the inside. He takes that whip, and he drives. He drives. I grew up in a church. I got to hurry. I grew up in a church where I saw Jesus holding the lamb, and he just looked like this guy that was so mellow, so laid back. Come on, you know what I'm talking about? And yet, whenever I read John chapter 2, he don't sound like he's very mellow there. Come on. He drives them out. And you know what? When they see this happen, here's what it says. Here's what it says. It says, passion for God's house. They remembered. They remembered the Old Testament said about the coming Messiah, passion for God's house will consume him. I'm going to be like Jesus. I'm going to be passionate about the house. And if this is the house God has planted me in, I'm going to be passionate about this house. Now, I want to wrap it up. I've got verses I don't have time to read, but you'll remember them if you've been in church very long at all. One thing that can happen whenever our passion begins to wane, we begin to lose our passion, that our love begins to grow cold. Think about it. Passion is what keeps love hot. When passion, it's like the embers. Passion is the embers. The fire that's burning on the inside keeps your love hot. Do you remember in the book of Revelations when Jesus is speaking to each of the churches? There's a message in there to, I don't care where you are in the body of Christ, I promise you, there's a message to you in those letters to the 7 churches. And he says, hey, listen, let me read it real quick, because if I don't, I'll mess this part up. Says this. He says, I know your works. He said, I know your works. You're still doing stuff, but here's the deal, that you're neither cold nor hot. And he says, I would that you were cold or hot, because if you're lukewarm, I'll spit you out of my mouth. I wonder how you would taste in Jesus' mouth right now. Come on. I wonder, hot, cold. See, I thought for a long time that meant hot on fire, cold indifferent. That's not what it means. That word hot, there were hot springs in one city that was a ways from Laodicea, and there was another city a ways from Laodicea, and they had cool springs. This one had hot springs. This one had cool, refreshing water. What they did was they built aqueducts from each one of those cities, and they were going to have hot and cold water flowing into their city. Pretty creative, right? The only thing is, what they didn't factor in was by the time the hot water traveled through the aqueducts, it became lukewarm. And by the time the cold water flowed through the aqueducts, it became lukewarm. And the hot water wasn't good for healing, and the cold water wasn't good for refreshing. He says, listen, I want you to be good for the purposes that I've called you to do, that called you to serve. I would that you were cold or hot. Come on, be one of those things. Because if you're lukewarm, I'll just spit you out of my mouth. Yeah. And then in Revelation chapter 2, he actually talks about the church. He said, I have this against you. You've abandoned your first love. Everybody say, abandon your first love. So here's what happens. Sometimes when we start growing cold in our walk with God, we don't realize it's going to take a big-time toll on us. We're going to become lukewarm. We're not going to be effective in ministry. We are also taking a very real chance of getting to a place where we just abandon. We just abandon our love for God. We don't show up in church. We don't pursue our walk with God as passionate as we once did. People say, I would never do that. I promise you, they said the same thing in Revelation chapter 2. Oh, we'd never abandon our love. You get cold enough, you get indifferent enough, you will walk away from your relationship with God. So, what do we do? What do we do? How do we get our passion back, and how do we keep our passion where we are never lacking in zeal? Number one, this is all in Revelation. He says, or not all of the first two are. He says, repent. Everybody say, repent. Repent is not what we think it is. Repent is not, oh God, forgive me. It is that, yes, on the front end, but it means this. It means to turn around and go the other direction. If this is the way I've been going and I've been doing stuff that is not keeping me hot for God and passionate about the things of God, I need to turn and I need to go in this direction and start doing the right thing. You haven't repented until you turn around and go the other direction. Asking God to forgive you is the start. You haven't repented until you turn around. Then he says, go back and do your first works. Remember what you did when you first fell in love with Jesus? He says, go back and do that. Go back and do the same things. Fall in love with his word. Spend time in his presence. What you did then that kept you hot, it will still keep you hot. Number three, guard your heart. Guard your heart of offense. Man, it's so easy to get offended in church, get offended in marriage, whatever, and then we lose our passion for the person, for the thing that we once loved, because we're offended over something that, again, is often petty. Either way, we need to forgive it because it's affecting our relationship with God or with somebody else. Amen? Number four, stay full of the Holy Spirit. Stay full. Somebody says, I got filled with the Holy Spirit 40 years ago. I know, but there's a problem. You leak. We all leak. Life takes a toll on you. You have to be continually filled with the Spirit. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 17. Don't be drunk with wine. That'll get you in trouble. But be filled. Be filled. Be continually filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen? How do I stay filled with the Holy Spirit? In time in God's presence. Asking God, fill me with your Spirit, Lord. Help me to be full of you as I walk out of this place. Last but not least, take responsibility for your fire. Never be lacking in zeal. But keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. He didn't say, hey, go to church on Sunday and your pastor is responsible for keeping your fire going. And, you know, he ought to preach a great message. You ought to have great worship. You know, it's the church's responsibility. You know, I'm just kind of cold. My church is not. Listen, you can't blame the church for where you are spiritually. It's your fire. You have to take responsibility for keeping it hot. Amen? Ooh, yeah. See, that's the thing about passion. It's like a fire. And if you don't tend it, it'll grow cold and it'll go out. You got to keep. Get anything out of this? Can you tell I'm passionate about talking to you about being passionate today? I am so very passionate. You know why? Because I want to see you hot for God. I don't want to see you growing lukewarm, kind of cold, kind of indifferent. I want to see you hot and on fire.